Today we are going to build an absolutely massive fantasy diorama, but we're not going to spend a single cent. Over the last 20 years of scenery crafting, I have built a lot of terrain. Many projects you've seen on this channel, some that are relics of the past yet to be unearthed, and some that to this day have never been finished. As we move to Aotearoa, New Zealand to begin our new life in Middle-earth, I have a very small window to try and finish as many as I can before they are left behind forever. Every piece in my storage unit is going to be either shipped to the new studio, sold, or if it's not finished, dumped in the trash. Today we're kicking off two insane weeks of rapid fire crafting with one of the oldest unfinished projects in my storage unit. A board that was supposed to be the third major crafting journey for this channel right after my first attempts at Osgiliath and Edoras. The snowy, ruined, overgrown city of Fornost in the fallen kingdom of Arnor in the north of Middle-earth. The aim of this build is to smash out an awesome landscape as quickly as possible without spending a single cent. I will not buy any materials. We have to make do with whatever I can find in my unit. What's sitting here on the table is an absolute slice of history of Zorpazorp. We've got some of the earliest projects ever. I think this was the third video ever on the channel, this Weathertop ruin. We've got heaps of old scanner terrain from the early days, 2018, 2019, and then even right up to here, this piece is from the Mark of Kelth, just under a year ago. Somehow, I've got to bring all of these elements together and build them into one cohesive fantasy diorama layout. Let's get cracking.
This build never made it very far. I essentially just marked out a floor plan for the city layout on a timber and foam baseboard, and then built up a ridiculous foundation for the city's ruined wall. I was going to build the entire city from plaster bricks that I had fallen in love with when making my old Weathertop ruin.
Welcome to Zorpazorp Gaming.
My goodness, that video is a blast from the past, but sadly, most of the cast bricks got co-opted for the Pelennor Fields outer ring wall, as well as a series of tournament scatter terrain for an event I was running at the time. We can't use the outer wall, it is well and truly off limits within the Siege of Gondor Megapod, but we can keep the original plan, as I not only have a bunch of spare Hearstarts cast bricks left over, but I recently found an old dusty tub containing those original scatter ruins, albeit absolutely trashed after 5 years of tournaments in my local gaming scene. Salvaging this build might be a little trickier than I thought, but up first it's time to hear a word from today's sponsor. Bloodline Heroes of Lithis is a visually stunning fantasy RPG available for free right now on both Android and iOS. It has amazing 3D realistic graphics, especially for a mobile game, but the really unique draw for me is the hybrid gameplay. You can collect new fantasy characters that are being released into the game every fortnight with sleek designs, and then customize your champions by marrying any two bloodlines in the game together, like elves, orcs, lycans, demons, demigods, dragonborn, vampires, and more, to create over 800 new fantasy hybrids. Now, the hybrids don't just look cool, they also inherit the talents and traits from each of the different characters. That creates some super cool gameplay combos. In 2023, all players can enjoy battling in the new Guild War on brand new maps. You conquer territories with your guild members and claim rewards to create the most unique hybrid champions called Bloodcraft Legends. Download the game for free on both Android and iOS, and if you use my link in the description or scan the QR code showing on the screen, you'll get a special starter pack worth $20 containing one summoning crystal, 100,000 gold, and 100 diamonds. For the next 7 days, the first 20 players who leave their in-game account ID and username in the comment section below will receive a free legendary female orc champion, Ugrul, one of the best warriors to carry you in the game. My first big decision was how to use the bridge and the causeway piece that I made for the Mark of Kelth. This piece was basically a one-off that allowed me to convert the standard Minas Tirith layout into an alternate castle formation for use in our Mark of Kelth campaign, as well as other Gondorian castles and fortresses, but I experimented with just cannibalizing it into this build, and I just couldn't reconcile the huge depth of the piece, so I just eventually canned it. But I did love the idea of having a river or a stream running running through the city. In fact, I even drew that in on my original plans on the foundation, so I had a big play with my buildings and the layout, eventually realizing that I needed one more final larger structure to help balance out the city, so I had to cannibalize the poor old Arnorian Tower from Zorpazorp Video 3. And then, after finally locking some positions for my buildings with a few little bridges over the stream and some cool roadways passing down from the ruined causeway and winding through the buildings, with my layout marked up, I ripped everything off, and we are now going to build upwards, starting at our deepest point, the riverbed. I cut into the old foam foundation and then used a chisel to pry out the chunks all the way down to the bedrock, which was quite the task. The winding pattern of the bed and the fierce adhesive I used back in the day not only worked out my hands, but it even claimed a sacrifice. One of my oldest chisels that I got when I was 9 years old for Christmas. You have served me well, old friend. Then I dug through my storage unit and found another box of Herstart's bricks, laid out everything I had, and started working away at building up the walls of the river. I wanted this to be part natural, part built-up canal, combining natural rock face with Arnorian stone walls. So I started by building up some brick retaining walls that would become the foundation of our bridges leaning down from the gatehouse. Before gluing any of the top layer of bricks down, I textured the section of road in and around the bricks with the only textured roller that I could find in my hobby tools marked boxes from the unit. This doesn't look as nice as our normal modeling compound method, but it's nice enough for a quick board and it saves so much time and materials. Remember folks, not a single cent spent. I then slapped together a simple bridge using floor tiles on a piece of cardboard and glued that down, and then started on the second bridge on the western side of the board, which was much the same, and I then began to build in our first rock molds, just jamming them in there and gluing them in with PVA for the time being. I decided for gameplay that we'd need a few areas of this canal that could be forded, other than the two bridges, so that they weren't two really tiny choke points. So I carved away the canal wall here and there, as if it had sort of collapsed down into the stream. This looked like it would work really well, so I added a second collapse section in the center between the two bridges, and then kept adding bricks and cliffs along the canal until I have a pretty rough treatment of that whole water feature. Before blending all the rockwork and adding our fine details, I grabbed my roller and put down flagstone texture all over the board, anywhere that should have been a road and might have some texture showing through. Then it was time to rapidly level up our city's density by gluing down our existing buildings, just with some liquid nails to grub the baseboards, which had sort of warped in a bit. Yeah, they're kind of old, right? And then I had to reassemble the broken jumble of pieces that I'd salvaged from the Weathertop Tower, which proved a little tricky, but pretty manageable. I settled on a nice orientation to suit the forded riverbank and then slapped down the last three ruins to be the beginning of ruined gatehouses and fortifications for our outer wall. Then, after repairing a few broken bits here and there, I grabbed some modeling compounds and began to blend all of the rock molds together into a cohesive rock face. I also used the compound to build up the forded sections of the canal, but instead of doing it with pure compound, I threw down a few foam spaces to kind of build that up a bit, and then I built compound over the top of those. Once this is all filled with base-ready rubble, it's going to look very, very convincing. The last modeling compound job for now was blending the very obvious scatter terrain bases into the board to make them feel a bit more like a realistic stone foundation that's just since been covered in rubble. With those joints smoothed over, the city is really taking shape, but there's still one last feature that needs some serious work, and that is our outer wall. I was going to do this with cast bricks like the rest of the city, but I'm basically completely out of the straight brick pattern, so I dug through the unit and I found an old box of broken up foam mold masters from when we made our Gondorian stairwells, and I had a big play and an experiment trying to find some way to use part of them for a very, very ruined wall. I started with the eastern smaller section, stacking together a few pieces and then carving them back to kind of match the damage profile of that small gatehouse and that sort of it joins onto at the side. Then I added a few extra bricks and bits of texture where it was needed to cover up any unfinished foam. The next section along was made using a really long part of the old roof stairwell, which I slapped down in sections, cutting it to size to slot between those two ruins, and then I ripped up one end to make a breach, and then added a pretty beat up old stairwell on the inner side, which should make for some really interesting gameplay, I think. Then the final side was made using a really big chunk of the original upper stairwell, which fit nicely between the big ruin and the edge of the board. My sort of intent here is that this ruin that's in the middle was like once a really large bastion that's since completely crumbled, but the stairwell that was going up to it remains, now climbing to nothing. This piece needed some stairwell extending to replace a lost piece, and then I grabbed a few of my very last straight cast bricks to try and blend the gatehouse in a little with the stairwell. I also used some of the old pieces of stonework to make a little retaining wall where the gatehouse ruin jutted out over the original foundation. This looks super dodgy right now, but she'll be right, mate. Just you wait and see. Then I grabbed the very last of my modeling compound and started blending these new sections as best I could. Normally I would have done a lot more than this, but I'm simply out of materials, so I'm gonna have to rely on the rubble to hide a lot of my dodgy areas. I left that all to dry overnight, took it back to my mother-in-law's garage, and gave the whole piece a massive prime with spray paint. I tried to keep the areas of the existing buildings that were painted, basically so I could save on paint and labor, and then gave a rough go at protecting some of the rock molds I sprayed so that we can leopard spot paint them later on. I used dark gray and then light gray and then just a big black acrylic wash on everything. This was all applied so roughly. The vast majority of this stuff is going to be covered in ground texture and snow, and most of the stonework is already painted, right? So just rough and fast. The rockwork was painted with a mix of washes straight onto that plaster, using the absorbent nature of the plaster rock molds to blend those washes together. That gets a really nice natural finish. That's it for painting. So simple, right? Once those painting stages are done, we're up to my favorite part though. And up first, it is trees. Yes, we are finally adding some greenery to a Zorpazorp layout. This won't just be another boring old gray urban war zone. This time, it's gonna be a really overgrown urban war zone. The trees that I have on hand are just a bunch of old snowy Christmas pines, which I bought from Aldi, super cheap, like 5 years ago for easy tournament trees for our local gaming scene. Bought like 20 packs of these things. I've got hundreds of them. So I'm just going to throw these around everywhere. The more, the merrier. That's an accidental Christmas pun. That's so good. The best way to get a nice looking board that is fun to play on is to do lots of little clumps of single pines, not these like huge static blocks of 10 or something, because that way you're sort of fighting amongst this little spread of trunks. It makes it way more enjoyable for gameplay. I lined them all up over the board and then I ripped off their silly little plastic bases and then glued the wire rod straight down into the board, and those aren't going anywhere. With the trees down, the next is ground covering, and this is the most fun I've had doing ground covers in a long time because we have greenery. I used my rubble blend made from Geek Gaming rubble base readies for all the broken stonework, and then I mixed in Geek Gaming rugged fields, which I have to say has never been my favorite, but man, it just looks fantastic on this board. It's a brownie green blend of aggregates and sawdust scatter, which I don't normally like to use, but it's perfect for this greeny brown earth that's sort of showing through the rubble. So I mix this kind of heavily around the fortifications of the outer wall where sort of more earthenware would have been exposed by erosion. And I also built it up all around my pine trees to form a layer of pine needles and little mosses. In the riverbed, I used something different to kind of give it a different vibe, some scrublands, which is a bit more stony, so it sort of feels a bit more riverbeddy, and then a really heavy covering of green blend foam flock for sort of the mossy buildup over those stones. Even though it's going to be a dry riverbed, there's going to be a lot more moisture there than around the rest of the city, except for those areas where the canal wall has collapsed. So that's going to be the grey rubble from the city because that's all slumped down into the canal. Then to begin sealing the board, I soaked it in isopropyl alcohol and Geek Gaming matte scenic sealant, which I applied with spray bottles. And then I actually got a bit of a syringe this time and just squirted heaps of it into the really dense areas of rubble. That's all going to be locked down super tight. While I do that, I just want to say a huge thank you to my YouTube channel members and my patrons. The support you guys show me and the banter in our Discord is like so important to me. This wouldn't be possible without you. I can't wait to reveal all the exciting new updates to the Patreon channel member family once we have our new dedicated Zorptron studio in the new house in New Zealand. If you'd like to become a Zorptron, simply hit the join button here on YouTube and down next to subscribe to smash it down there, or you can check out Patreon linked down in the description. Who doesn't want to be a Zorptron? Come on, join the family. With the board still wet, I then began to build up our lichen and our moss by sprinkling green blend foam flock into the rubble and the ground cover, just kind of sporadically to give a little bit of green patchiness. And it just had a really nice pop of green, just brought the city alive and started to sort of tie the whole board together. We are cooking with gas, man. It just looks so good. Another pass of sealant to get that really, really tight. And then it is Snow time. Now, normally when I'm doing snow, I go straight to my favorite snow product, the Snow Powder Base Ready from Geek Gaming, as always. All these Geek Gaming products you can get from my shop, Zorpazorp.com. I used this last on my Moria display board. It looks absolutely amazing, but I don't have any here in the storage unit, and all of my shop stock for Zorpazorp.com is up in the warehouse in Brisbane, and I need this board done straight away so that we can move on to all the other half-finished projects. So in the spirit of using up old resources, this time I stumbled upon an old box of Christmas decoration snow spray that I bought like a decade ago, the very first time I dreamed up doing a Fornost board. Now these cans absolutely suck, and I'm not promoting them at all. They're terrible. I've got 17 cans. Six of them straight up didn't work. Another six, the propellant didn't mix with the snow, so nothing but air came out. And of the remaining five, they were just like so inconsistent with coverage. Some of it was like thick and fluffy, and some of it really sparse. After this, I just threw the rest of them all in the bin. Now, I don't want to cover the whole board, right? We don't want to get rid of all this amazing ground covering we've built up. So the look that I'm going for is like a style of snow coverage that looks like there's been some very light snowfall, and maybe it's begun to sort of partially melt, rather than that like snowfield thick carpet of dense white snow. If I'm being honest, this probably isn't that realistic of a look, especially as all the trees have sort of the same amount of snow and the ground's a bit uneven. I tried to break that up a little bit by adding some more snow to some trees, but maybe this doesn't perfectly mimic like nature, but man, it just looks really good. You get that juxtaposition of the little white patches with all the greens and grays that were built up. It's awesome. I'm loving it. I didn't put any snow in the riverbed because I have actually decided since that I'll probably add a bit of resin to that at a later date, but for now, this board is done, and now I just have to decide, am I going to keep this for myself or chuck it up for sale? I have to be honest, for a board that only used existing materials to spruce up and combine old builds and only took me 5 days to build, shoot, and edit, this is pretty damn good. But is it good enough? Only time will tell.